إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We welcome you once again to the sixth educational seminar hosted by the Islamic Center of Palm Beach entitled The Path That Leads to Allah is One. We thank all of you for coming and we ask Allah that this be a gathering from the gatherings of much benefit, and we ask that Allah He sent His blessing and aid each and every one of you to increase yourselves in knowledge and action. So we'll begin today with the first lecture, actually the second lecture of our last day of this seminar, with our beloved, dear, respected brother Abu Khadija Abdul Wahid, Hafidhahu Allah. And for those of you who have not been here, Abu Khadija is from the UK, and from a city called Birmingham, from Maktab al-Salafiyya. And we are honored to have him. Inshallah, he will present to you some works, beneficial works from the ulama. And without further ado, we will begin.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد. So now today, inshallah, I'll begin with the second portion of that which I wish to discuss, and that is related to what it means to be a Salafi. The term is obviously bandied around quite often amongst the people. Sometimes people who are not even upon what it means to be a Salafi call themselves Salafi. Others are ignorant of the fact or ignorant of what it means to be a Salafi. Others are scared away from it, thinking that this is a sect amongst all of the other sects of Islam, and this is just another sect. You have Ikhwan al-Muslimin, you have Jamaat al-Jihad, you have Jamaat Ikhwan al-Muslimin, you have Jamaat Islami, you have various groups, Al-Qutubiyya, Al-Sururiyya, you have the various sects of Sufism, whether it be the Naqshbandiyya, or the Sahawardiyya, or the Chishtiyya, or the Qadiriyya, or the Tijaniyya, and they think that Salafiyya is just another grouping from all of those groupings. So what I wish to discuss here today is what it means to be a Salafi. First and foremost, of course, a Salafi is an individual who makes intisab to a group of individuals who were called the Salaf. So a Salafi, the ya at the end, the ya nisbi, which is called the ya nisbi, or the ya at the end of a description, in English you'd add the I. So instead of Salaf, Salafi. Instead of, for example, Pakistan, Pakistani. Sudan, Sudani. What does the I or the double E at the end do? What does that signify, brothers? That you are from that land, or from those people, or that you ascribe yourselves to those people. One from Medina, Madani. One from Mecca, Makki. One from Yemen, Yemeni. So this is an. So the one who calls himself Yemeni is not saying I am Yemen. Of course, the one who says that I am Pakistani, he's not saying I am Pakistan. The one who's from America, he's not saying, when he calls himself Amriki, He's not saying I'm America. He's saying that I'm from America. Why ascribe myself to that land because I was born there, or I lived there, or I was raised there? So likewise, the one who says that he is Salafi, he's in actuality ascribing himself to something. What is he ascribing himself to? A group of people who are known to us as the Salaf. And the Salaf, as the scholars have mentioned, such as Ibn Mundur, in his tremendous dictionary of the Arabic language, and other than Ibn Mundur, Imam al-Baghawi, and the likes of Imam al-Sam'ani, that the term Salaf refers to those who came before us. Literally, it refers to those who came before us. Ibn Mundur, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions, was-salaf, aydan, he mentions the Salaf also. He said it refers to the one who came before you, from your forefathers, from those who are close to you, from your relatives, those who died before you, and those who were upon the generations or the nations and the generations that came before you. And he mentions, for this reason, the first generations of Muslims from the Sahaba and the Tabi'een, they were called As-Salaf As-Salih. They were called As-Salaf As-Salih, meaning that they were called the righteous Salaf. This is in Lisanul Arab of Ibn Mundur, the great scholar of the Arabic language, who happened to be actually from Africa, rahimahullah ta'ala. So here we find that the Prophet sallallahu, or that the Salaf, or the great scholars of the past, that they used to use the term Salaf to refer to those who came before them. And as we've mentioned, this statement from the tongue of the Arabs in the Arabic language, what it means, those who came before you are known as the Salaf. Furthermore, we have that beautiful narration from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Fatima radiyallahu anha, on an occasion he said to her, فَإِنَّهُ نِعْمَ السَّلَفْ عَنَا لَكِ. He said to Fatima radiyallahu anha upon his deathbed, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hadith in Sahih Muslim, and it is authentic, rather it is reported in the Sahihain, Bukhari and Muslim, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَإِنَّهُ نِعْمَ السَّلَفْ عَنَا لَكِ. He said that indeed I am to you a blessed Salaf. A blessed Salaf. Ni'ma Salaf. I am a blessed Salaf to you. So here the Prophet ﷺ is saying what to Fatima? He's saying to Fatima that I am one who has preceded you in a good manner, in a blessed manner. So here the Prophet ﷺ is informing Fatima radiallahu anha that he is her Salaf, that he is one who has preceded her. Likewise, that we find from the statement of Imam al-Nawawi, the Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, when he explained, because Imam al-Nawawi has an explanation of Sahih Muslim, or the Sharh of Sahih Muslim, Sharh Sahih Muslim, of Imam al-Nawawi rahimahullah. He mentions that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in this hadith that we have just said, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Fatima radiyallahu anha, فَاتَّقِ اللَّهَ وَاصْبِرِي. He said to her, fear Allah and be patient. Why? Because Fatima was losing her father. He's about to die, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She loved him. So she was feeling that anxiety that a daughter feels when her father is to die. But not only, you know, a father, but also a prophet, a messenger, one who brought revelation. So he said to her, fear Allah, فَاتَّقِ اللَّهِ وَاصْبِرِي, and be patient. فَإِنَّهُ نِعْمَ السَّلَفْ أَنَا لَكِ. For indeed I am to you a blessed Salaf. And I am to you a blessed predecessor, one who came before you. So he said, Imam al-Nawawi, in explanation of that, as-salaf al-mutaqaddim. He said that this is the salaf that precedes, that came before, that preceded you. وَمَعْنَاهُ أَنَا مُتَقَدِّمٌ قُدَّامَكِ. That I am one who has preceded you and come before you. I am one who is, you know, who has come before and I'm preceded you. And that you should return but to me, that you shall return to me. Meaning after death. So here, we find that the Salaf of this, or the great scholars of this Ummah, the Salaf of this Ummah, that they used to use the term Salaf. But really the question here is it permissible for an individual to use any other term apart from Muslim? And the answer is yes. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself used terms other than the term Muslim. Of course, because everyone who says La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, he faces the Qibla in his Salah, he accepts the Qur'an, that it is the Messenger of Allah, and he worships Allah alone upon Tawheed, he is a Muslim. However, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not restrict the term to those who are upon the guided path. He did not restrict it to only the term Muslim. And there are many examples, because many of the people, they criticize and they say, no, you can't call yourself Salafi. And then they give their reasons. Number one, we should just call ourselves Muslim. Number two, the term Salafi divides the Ummah. So our answer to this is from various aspects. First and foremost, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, what he said to Fatima radiallahu anha, that I am to you a blessed Salaf. And likewise, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, سَتَفْتَرِكُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ عَلَىٰ ثَلَاثٍ وَسَبْعِينَ فِرْقَةٍ كُلُّهَا فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا وَاحِدًا وَهِيَ الْجَمَاعَةِ. He said, indeed this nation will divide into 73 sects. All of them into the hellfire except for one. And that is the Jama'ah. What did he use? What term did he use? Jama'ah. He didn't say, and they are the Muslims. Why? Because all of the 73 sects, all of them are Muslim. But he said that all of them are into the hellfire, meaning that Allah will punish them. Not forever, not for eternity. But Allah will punish them in accordance to their deviation. As a punishment because they opposed that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. So Allah will punish them for a time. But then he said, except for one group. And he said, one firqa. كُلُّهَا فِي النَّارِ إِلَّا وَاحِدًا. All of them to the hellfire except for one. وَهِيَ الْجَمَاعَةِ. The term he used, Jama'ah. He didn't use the term Muslim. Also from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, بَدَأَ إِسْلَامُ غَرِيبًا. The Islam began as something غريب, strange. فَيَعُوذُ غَرِيبًا كَمَا بَدَعَ. And it will return as something strange just as it began. فَطُوبَ لِلْغُرَبَى. So he said, let the glad tidings be to the غُرَبَى, be to the strangers. He didn't say let the glad tidings be to the Muslims. He said glad tidings for the ghuraba, for the strangers. So here again we find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not using the term Muslim, but rather using the term ghuraba. In the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in one of the wordings, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that this ummah will divide into 73 sects, all of them into the hellfire except for one, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that they are hum as-suwadul a'zam. That they are the main body. He didn't say they are Muslims, he called them As-Suwadul A'adam, the main body. In a narration, the Prophet ﷺ said, he was asked by the Sahaba, وَمَا هِيَ تِلْكَ الْفِرْقَى. The Sahaba said, which is that firqa? Sect. Which is that sect? The Prophet ﷺ didn't say, don't call it a sect. Don't call it firqa. He didn't correct them on that. Because had they made a mistake in that ibarah, in that term, had the Sahaba made a mistake in using the term firqa, then the Prophet ﷺ would have said, no, do not call that same sect a firqa. Don't call them firqa. He would have corrected them, but he didn't correct them. Rather, he said, they are those who are upon that which I and my companions are upon. So this is why the Prophet ﷺ, this is why it is also called firqatun najiyah. That all of them are into the hellfire except for one firqa, firqatun najiyah. The one saved sect. In a narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La tazalu ta'ifatun min ummati mansurun wa mansurin ala al-haq." That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that they will never remain, or they will never cease to remain, a group from my ummah who are mansurin, that they are aided, a group of ta'ifa, la tazalu min ummati ta'ifatun mansurin, that they will never cease to be a ta'ifa. Ta'ifa means a group that are mansurin, meaning that they are aided. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the early scholars of the Muslims, that they used to say, so there is a group that will never cease to remain in the Ummah of Muhammad, meaning that there is one group amongst all of the various groupings upon all of their different parts, there is one group that will remain aided. And this is why it is called At-Ta'ifa Al-Mansura. Because of this hadith, in Sahih Muslim by the way, that there will never cease to be a group from my Ummah that is aided upon the truth. In a wording, the Prophet said, ظَاهِرِينَ عَلَى الْحَقِّ, that they are manifestly upon the truth.
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, أشهد أن محمداً رسول الله، أشهد أن محمداً رسول الله، حي على الصلاة، حي على الصلاة، حي على الفلاح، حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
So this group that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned, that they will never cease to be a group from the Ummah manifestly upon the truth, ظاهرين على الحق, and they are mansurin ala al-haq, that they are aided by Allah upon the truth. So here again the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not use the term Muslim. He used these terms, all these different terms that we have mentioned, al-jama'ah, firqa, tunajiyah, which is the ta'ifatul mansura. All of these terms are used. Athar, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when he was asked the question, they said to him, Ya Rasulullah, which of mankind are the best? He said, Ana. He said, me. ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ He said, me. أَنَا وَالَّذِينَ مَعِي And those alongside me. ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ عَلَى الْأَثَرِ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ عَلَى الْأَثَرِ So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked the question, which of mankind are the best? He said, أَنَا, me. And those alongside me. Then those who follow their أَثَرِ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ عَلَى الْأَثَرِ Those who are upon the أَثَرِ, meaning those who are upon that path. Then those who are upon that path. And this is why the early scholars of this ummah used to call Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah Ahlul Athar. Those who follow the path, or those who follow, and Athar also, as it is also used, Athar is used also synonymously with the term Hadith. And Athar is also used as the wordings of the Sahaba. Any statement of the Sahaba is referred to as an Athar. Or the statements of the Tabi'een are referred to as an Athar. And the wordings of the, or the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are referred to as Hadith. But sometimes they can be used interchangeably. So the term athar we find in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So one should not be so adamant in believing that the term Salafi, or other than Salafi, cannot be used, and that it wasn't used. Rather, it was used. It was used by the early scholars. Then the question is, what is the madhab of the Salaf? And what is the madhab of the Salafi? Time doesn't allow, of course, to go through. In reality, you know, there's two or three books that we can completely finish, probably take a few years, but nevertheless, we're trying to now put all of this into a concise one or two lectures. But the Salafi follows the Salaf of this Ummah. We know the Salaf of this Ummah are the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his Sahaba, radiallahu anhum. They are the ones who have been described by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. والسابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين تبعوهم بإحسان رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه وأعد لهم جنات تجري تحتها الأنهار خالدين فيها أبدا ذلك الفوز العظيم So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ The first and foremost to embrace Islam and believe from the muhajireen and from the ansar وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ And those who follow them precisely رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ That Allah is pleased with them, they are pleased with Him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised for them jannat, promised for them gardens of paradise. تَجْرِي تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ Under which rivers flow. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا Under which rivers flow and they will remain therein forever. And that is the supreme success. So here Allah mentioned three groups of people that Allah is pleased with. And that Allah will enter into the gardens of paradise. And Allah will keep them there forever and eternally. Only three groups of people. He did not mention a fourth. He did not mention a fourth group of people that he's pleased with. He's pleased with three people and three groups of people from this ummah after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah mentions the muhajireen. Then he mentions the ansar. Then he mentions those who follow them precisely. Bi ihsan. These are the only three groups of people from the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that Allah is pleased with. That's why he only mentioned those three. So therefore, we have to be in one of these three to earn the pleasure of Allah. We have to be in one of these three. Muhajirun. Anyone here from Muhajirin? Anyone here from the Ansar? No. So that only leaves us in the third category. Those who follow them precisely. Bi ihsan. بِإِتْقَان As Shaykh al-Fawzan mentions that those who follow them بِإِحْسَان in goodness meaning precisely just as when Jibreel alayhi salam when he said to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the hadith of Jibreel he said أَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ الْإِحْسَان inform me regarding إِحْسَان what did he say? أَن تَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَى that you worship Allah As though you see him, and even though you do not see him, فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ Indeed, he sees you. So what is ihsan? Ihsan is the precision and the beautification and the goodness and the best of worship that a person can perform. This is ihsan. This is why the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said what he said, that you worship Allah as though you see him. Meaning what? In the best, most precise possible form. In the best way that you worship Allah. As though you see Him. And even though you do not see Him, indeed He sees you. So ihsan here means perfection. That those who enter into Jannah, and those whom Allah is pleased with, those who are not from the deviated sects are these groups of people. These three. About whom Allah said, رضي الله عنه ورضوا عنه Muhajirin, Ansar, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ And those who follow them, in ihsan. Likewise, the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, so that should be clear in our minds. Likewise, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ رَسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُسْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاعَتْ مَسِيرًا Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that whomsoever contends with the Messenger of Allah, after the guidance has been conveyed to him, and then he chooses a path, other than the path of the believers, the Sahaba. Here, the Sahaba. The Mu'mineen, the Sabeel al-Mu'mineen here, is the Sahaba. Why? Because the ayah was revealed upon whom? Upon the Sahaba. So Allah is informing mankind that whomsoever contradicts the Messenger, after the guidance, and then he opposes the path of the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, then Allah will leave him in the path that he has chosen and burn him in the hellfire. And what an evil destination. Likewise, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَقَدْ اِهْتَدَوْا That if they believe, as you, Sahaba, believe, then they are guided. This is what Allah mentions in the Quran. That if they, the people, believe as you believe, antum, Allah mentions it in the plural, so he's not referring to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Amantum bihi. If they believe, as you believe. That if those people believe, as you believe, then they are guided. Meaning that if they do not believe as you companions believe, then they will not be guided. Likewise, the statement of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam reporting the two sahihs from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Khayrun nas qarni, thumma alladhina yalunahum, thumma alladhina yalunahum." As Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The best of mankind is my generation. Then those who follow them, then those who follow them." Salaf. This is what we're referring to here. Likewise, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was asked the question, "Ayyu nas khayr?" Which of mankind are the best? He said, "Qar al qarnu ladhi ana fihi," the generation that I am in right now. This is the best generation. Thumma thani, thumma thalith. The hadith in Sahih Muslim. Then the second generation, then the third generation. So now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has laid out for us, and Allah subhanahu wa taala in His book has told us which are the generations that are to be followed. So there should be no doubt in the Muslim, 1400 years later, or 1000 years later, or 2000 years later, there should be no doubt in the mind of the Muslim that the generation that is the best to be followed in every way, in your belief, in your actions, in your deeds, in your statements, in the way that you worship Allah, in the way that you get married, the way that you bury your dead, the way that you raise your children, the best generation to emulate is that generation. The generation of the that was raised in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, in the beginning of his Risala al-Mashhura, in the beginning of his treatise, which is well known with the term Usul Sunnah, which is translated actually and it is available, Usul Sunnah of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, or the foundations of the Sunnah. Look what Imam Ahmad said. He said, "Usul Sunnati indana at-tamassaku bima kana alayhi ashabu Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wal-iqtida'u bihim." That he said, rahimahullah, and Imam Ahmad died in the year 241 after the Hijrah. He said that the foundations of the Sunnah with us is to hold fast to that which the companions of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were upon. وَالْإِقْتِدَاءُ بِهِمْ, and to take them as a model to be emulated. وَتَرْكُ الْبِدْعَى, and to abandon innovations, meaning to abandon everything that they were not upon by way of religion. وَكُلُّ بِدْعَةٍ فَهِيَ الضَّلَالَ, for every innovation, it is misguidance. Look how he began his fundamental work in the Aqeedah. He didn't say that from the usul of the Sunnah is to follow the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He didn't begin with that. He began with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Usul sunnati indana at-tamassaku bima kana alayhi ashabu rasulillahi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That the foundation, the very foundation of our Aqeedah, the very foundation of our religion, is to stick and to hold fast to that which the companions of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam were upon. Why? Because they carried the revelation. They understood the revelation. They carried the hadith. They memorized the hadith. They understood the hadith. They understood the asbab al-nuzul, or the reasons why these verses were sent down. What happened? What was happening when this verse came down? What was happening when that verse came down? What happened when this hadith came? What happened when that hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam uttered that? They were there watching. So when we look at the hadith, or when we look at the religion of Islam, we look at it through the lens of the Sahaba. As if we are looking at the religion as Abu Bakr saw it, as Umar saw it, as Uthman, Ali, as Aisha radiallahu anha, Salama, Abu Huraira, Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Abbas. We look at the religion as they understood the religion. So now when a person comes to that conclusion, he says to himself, from now on I'm going to look at the deen, every ayah, every hadith through the lens of the Sahaba. Then that's a life-changing moment in his life. It will alter his outlook upon his religion and how he now proceeds for the rest of his life, because he's no longer concerned with the screams and the shouting of the people of today. And what they bring by way of their innovations and their misguidance and their deviations. And in all of their forms, if we started talking about deviation now, we wouldn't stop talking for the next 6 months about all of the sects of deviation that are present in the United States of America, never mind the rest of the world. You will see this. But when a person now sits and he says to himself, today I make this change. Everything that I do from now on, I want to know, how did the Sahaba act upon it? How did they understand it? How did they see it? Lens of the Sahaba, marriage through the lens of the Sahaba. Because they will tell you, when the Prophet ﷺ married Zaynab radiallahu anha, he married her in that form. Or when the Prophet ﷺ married Aisha radiallahu anha, he was on such and such an occasion, and this took place. When so and so died, the Prophet ﷺ was sitting at the graveside, and then the body was buried and the lahad was made, and then the Prophet ﷺ made dua. And then the Prophet ﷺ said this, and we were sitting watching the Prophet ﷺ. This is how our deen is. When we look at the religion through the eyes of the Sahaba, through the lens of the Sahaba, through the sayings of the Sahaba, that makes you Salafi. This is what it means to be Salafi. This actual distinction is what distinguishes, is the greatest distinguishing factor between the methodology and the method that the Salafi employs as compared to the methodology of everybody else. Everybody else will have a unique methodology opposed to this one. And either you will recognize it in their speech or you'll recognize it in their actions. Because sometimes people will say, we do that as well. We look at the religion through the eyes of the Sahaba. But when you look at their actions actually oppose that. As Umar radiallahu anhu, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, in a narration from him that is collected by Imam Bukhari in Sahih, Umar radiallahu anhu said that in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we judge the people based upon revelation. Meaning what? That we knew who was a munafiq from revelation. We knew who was hiding from revelation. We knew who was showing correctly from revelation. We knew the best of the people from revelation. We knew the worst of the people from revelation. We knew who was going to go to hellfire from revelation. We knew who was going to paradise from revelation. We knew what was in the hearts of the people from revelation. Why? Because Allah would mention it in the Quran. Or the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would mention it upon his tongue. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never spoke from his desires, but rather it was revelation that was conveyed to him. So Umar radiallahu anhu said that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was alive, we judged the people by way of revelation. But after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then we judge the people from that which is apparent from them. What we see from their actions. So if they display that which is good, then we accept the goodness. And if they display that which is wicked, then we accept it to be wicked and to be punished in accordance to that. This is Umar radiallahu anhu, that a person is based upon that which is zahir from him. So if a person now attacks the Sahaba, curses Abu Bakr, curses Umar, curses Uthman, speaks ill of Abu Hurairah, curses Aisha, reviles Aisha radiallahu anha. In fact, they may even set up a day in their yearly calendar for the cursing of the Sahaba, as the Shia they do in Iran. The Ithna Sharia, not only in Iran, in Syria, in Lebanon, in Pakistan, in other places where there are high concentrations of Shia. Now the Shia will set out a day in which they just curse the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. And then they make divine Ali radiallahu anhu, because they believe that Ali is divine, like a god to them. So they call upon him, and Hussein, and Hassan, and Fatima. So they will take a few companions and they will worship them. And they will curse the rest of the companions. Then they say, we are upon Islam and we are upon revelation. And this is a lie to what they claim. Because their actions and their behavior shows that they are in contradiction to the revelation. Likewise, if a group of people come today, like we mentioned yesterday, those people who go around people's houses, knocking their doors, inviting them to the masjid. And they say, we are going to teach you Iman. And we are going to read from our book, which is called Fadailu A'mal, or Tabligh Nisa. So they read from this book, which is 70 to 80% fabricated and weak hadith. And within it there is shirk, and within it there is kufr. Within there is the dhikr that was never performed by the Prophet ﷺ, nor the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, ever. In this book that they read, I remember reading in one of their chapters years ago, in which they wrote that there was a young man who took his mother to Hajj. Took his mother to Hajj. And she was ill. So he said that we were near the Haram, and then we saw a cloud in the sky. On the cloud there was a man. Then the cloud descended. And when the man stepped off the cloud, I realized that it was the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said to me, what is wrong? He said, my mother is ill. So then the Prophet, he took his hand and he wiped the face of my mother and the belly of my mother. Wiped it. And she was cured. And then he said, oh young boy, oh young man, let me teach you something that you should recite often. And he said, what is that? He said, recite the Salatul Ibrahimiyyah, or the Salat, you know, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Ali Muhammad. So recite that often. And this is in their book. We say that this actual event contradicts the Kitab and the Sunnah from so many angles you cannot listen. Number one, who is the one who brings the cure? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number two, did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ever touch a foreign woman in his life?
No.
Never mind touching the belly of a woman. Never touched a foreign woman in his life. Thirdly, is it known that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the worst and in the hardest times of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum came down on a cloud to aid the Sahaba? Abu Bakr, Umar was stabbed. Uthman was besieged. Ali radiallahu anhu was assassinated by the sword of a Khariji that was laced with poison. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not come out of his grave for that or come descending upon a cloud for that. But he came for this. Also, that they have taken as a curer of the illnesses of the person, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is in their book, the Tabligh al-Nisa, written in their words. Then when you talk to them, they say, we follow the Sahaba. Do they follow the Sahaba? The Sahaba radiallahu anhu never sought aid from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his grave, nor did they seek intercession with him, nor did they seek cure from him. They sought it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the extent that when the rain was withheld in the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, and there was a drought in the time of the Sahaba, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had died, and there was a drought in the time of Umar. So the companion said that in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we used to go to the Messenger of Allah and he used to make dua and make Salatul Istisqa, or what is commonly known as the rain prayer, where they beseech and supplicate to Allah that Allah sends down the rain. They make the Salatul Istisqa. So what are we going to do now? Not a single companion said, let's go to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one. They said, indeed, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive, we used to go to him. Now that he's dead, let's go to his uncle Al-Abbas. So they went to the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Al-Abbas. And they said to him, we used to go to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now we're coming to you, will you lead us in the salah? Will you call upon Allah so that the rain comes down? So they did not go to the grave and make tawassul or wasila or shafa'ah. They went to a living person to ask him to make dua. Because when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive, they used to go to him and make dua. And he used to make dua for them, that Allah sends down the rain. So this is the way of Ahlul Sunnah, that we look at the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum never went out for 40 days knocking on the people's doors. And then when they knock on the door, they don't even know what they're calling you to. And they don't call to Tawheed. And they don't call to Iman, even though they say we are calling to Iman. But the Iman with this sect, known as Tabligh al-Nisab, is not the Iman of the Salaf. Because the Iman, the definition of Iman with the Salaf, is an Iman. قَوْلُ وَعَمَلُ يَزِيدُ وَيَنْقُصُ. That is, the Iman with the Salaf of this Ummah was speech and action. It increases and it decreases. And we mentioned this a few days ago. The Iman with the Salaf was speech and action. Speech of the heart, action of the limbs. Speech and actions of the heart. Speech of the tongue, actions of the limbs. It increases with obedience and decreases with disobedience to Allah. Within Iman is just speech of the tongue and belief in the heart. It does not increase and it does not decrease with them. That is their belief in Iman. So when they say, we are calling you to Iman, brother, they are not calling you to Iman, they are calling you to Irja, to the ideology of a sect that was apparent in the time of the Sahaba. Arose firstly in the time of the Sahaba. Some Ahlul Bidah, they came and they invented this new ideology, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhu refuted it from them. Anas ibn Malik, as Ibn Battah mentioned in his Shahul Ibana, that the Sahaba radiallahu anhu refuted those individuals who said that Iman does not increase and decrease, and Iman is only in the heart. We don't believe that Iman is only in the heart. We believe that Iman is belief in the heart, speech upon the tongue, actions of the limbs. The more you obey Allah, the stronger your Iman. The more that you disobey Allah, the weaker your Iman. So whenever you feel that your Iman is low, then do righteous deeds, my brothers and sisters. Whenever you feel that low point, and it happens to everyone. As in the hadith of Hanzalah in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, he said, he came to Abu Bakr, he said, Ya Abu Bakr, he was weeping and coming to Abu Bakr in a distressed state. He said, what is wrong, Hanzalah? He said, Hanzalah has become munafiq. Of course he wasn't a munafiq, but he felt it. Because his Iman was low. Because he said in that, when we are with the Prophet ﷺ, we feel so strong. Our faith is so strong, our Iman is strong, we feel so close to Allah. Then when we are with our families, we become weak. So he said, Abu Bakr said, in that case, Abu Bakr is munafiq. But then the Prophet ﷺ, he explained to them that were your Iman always to be that strong at all times, then you'd be shaking the hands of the angels in the streets of Medina. Meaning that Iman cannot. Iman is such a thing, my brothers and sisters, that it is going to fluctuate. You have low points, you have strong points. It happens to all of us. But then the Prophet ﷺ said, however, there is a time for this and there is a time for that. Meaning there will be a time for your family. And there is a time for seeking knowledge. There is a time for ibadah. There is a time for tahajjud. There is a time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you opportunity after opportunity to strengthen your Iman. Do those Tablighi Jamaat, did they explain that to you? Never. Because Iman to them is join our group. Then you are mu'min, mashallah. Join our group, give bayah to our Amir, then you are a believer. So long as you join our sect, and then you can stay there, and then you start traveling like they travel, calling the people to nothing except misguidance. When they need a guy, Muhammad Ilyas al-Kandahlawi, they buried him in the masjid in India. That's sunnah, that's sahaba. This is how the sahaba worked. That they would be buried inside of a masjid. When the masjid is for the worship of Allah, and you put dead bodies in the masjid. And the Prophet ﷺ said, may the curse of Allah be upon the Jews and the Christians. For indeed, when a righteous man or a prophet used to die from amongst them, they used to take his grave as a place of worship. So we keep the masajid away from the graveyards. Is it allowed to perform salah in the graveyard? Never! Except one salah. Which one? Janazah. For a purpose, for a need. Why is the janazah, salatul janazah, allowed and none of the other prayers are allowed? Why? Because in the janazah, is there any ruku'? Is there prostration? In the janazah, there is no ruku, no prostration, so you're not bowing in the graveyard and putting your head down next to a grave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cut off all the avenues towards shirk. You cannot go to a graveyard and make general dua, believing that in the graveyard that my dua is more likely to be accepted. Bid'ah! When you go to the graveyard and make dua for the deceased, there's a purpose for being in the graveyard. Two reasons. One, reminds you of death, as the Prophet ﷺ said, that I used to forbid you from visiting the graveyards, but now visit them, for indeed the graves will remind you of death. Second reason, that you supplicate for the deceased. When the Prophet ﷺ, on a night he disappeared, Aisha thought he went to the wife, to one of the other wives, so she became jealous. Because he slowly got up, left the house and went. So Aisha, being from the most of the jealous, most jealous of the wives of the Prophet ﷺ, she thought, where's he gone? It's my night. Radiallahu anha. That's what the Prophet ﷺ said about Aisha. This is the jealousy of your mother Aisha. Where's he gone? So she said, I got up, I covered myself, and I followed him secretly to see where he was going. So I followed him and followed him and followed him up until he reached the Baqi', the graveyard. where the Sahaba were buried. And then he stood and he supplicated to Allah for the dead, that Allah forgives them and showers His mercy upon them. And then the Prophet ﷺ, Jibreel informed him, she is following you. He said, then he turned. She said, when he turned, he didn't see me, so I raced back. Up until when I was lying in my bed, he recognized that I was breathing heavily because I was panting from racing back. He said, oh Aish. He said, he poked me in my chest. He said, oh Aish, what were you doing? She said, ya Rasulullah, I thought that you were. Jealousy of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he loved her. He said, oh my Lord, do not call me to account for my love of Aisha radiallahu anha. But nevertheless, at the graveyard, to go to the graveyard, let's say you have an exam tomorrow at college or wherever. You go to the graveyard and say, right, where is my dua going to be? I'll go to the graveyard. Oh Allah, I've got an exam tomorrow. Help me to pass the exam. And he's trying to use his presence in the graveyard as if this is now more likely that his dua is going to be accepted. Is that correct, ya akhwan? That's bid'ah. Even making that dua in a graveyard, in that manner, is an innovation. How about burying someone inside of a mosque? When the curse, there's a hadith or the athar from Ali radiallahu anhu. And I think it's collected by Abdul Razak in his Musannaf, if I remember correctly, that he saw a man standing by the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the man was standing with his head lowered in a state of khushur. You know, submissive, head lowered. And he said, what are you doing? He said, I'm standing by the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, fear Allah. Fear Allah. For indeed I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that the curse of Allah is upon the Jews and the Christians. Because they used to take the graves of their prophets and the graves of their righteous as places of worship. Now we're looking at the graveyard and the issue of the graves through the eyes of who? The lens of who? Sahaba. So they considered i'tikaf, standing and secluding oneself next to a grave, to be something that could earn the person the curse of Allah. Just doing that, submissiveness next to a grave, i'tikaf at a graveside. I'tikaf is for the masajid. You perform i'tikaf predominantly in Ramadan, even outside of Ramadan, in the masajid, not at a graveside. He said, what are you doing? He said, this is the grave of the... He feels something. But not like that, my brothers and sisters. What was the sunnah of the Sahaba when they went to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Look at Ibn Umar. He used to go to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he would say, "Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh." Then he used to move to one side, "Assalamu alayka ya Abu Bakr wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh." Then the same for his father Umar. This was the sunnah of the Sahaba. Not that you sit down and make i'tikaf for 3 days. This is not the sunnah of the Sahaba, making tawaf around it and saying, I've got to do something, I've got to, you know, the Christians, we've got to do something. What should we do? Let me think. You know, we're going to do something, throw some tinsel over the grave or something. That's the behavior of the Christians. They need to make something out of something. So now you find Muslims who do the same. So those people who claim to follow the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, It's not just a mere issue of claiming. Like those people who rebel against the Muslim, why do you rebel? Oh, the Muslim rulers are tyrannical. But it's forbidden to rebel. No, they're tyrannical. We have to remove their oppression. Look at the rulers. They're stealing the money of the Muslims. They're gambling. What are the rulers doing in the casinos of Europe? What are they doing in London? What are they doing in Paris? These rulers, look, they don't even practice as they should practice. Look, they imprison people, they beat people in their backs. We say, it is still not allowed to rebel. And they get shocked. And they say, don't rebel. Are you even a Muslim? We say, brother, you're not supposed to rebel against the ruler, even if he's tyrannical. No, I will not accept this. Why won't you accept this? What if I give you a hadith? From Hudhayfa, companion, let's look into the lens of Hudhayfa. Ibn al-Yaman. He said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, you will have over you rulers. You will have over you a'imma, not one ruler. Which proves that the rulers will be many in number. Not one ruler, you'll have rulers over you, a'imma over you. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, they will not follow my sunnah. And they will not follow my guidance. وَفِيهِمْ نَاسِ قُلُوبُهُمْ قُلُوبُ شَيَاطِينِ فِي جُثْمَانِ إِنْسِ. And amongst them there will be men who will have the hearts of devils in the bodies of human beings. Look at these three characteristics. Four, in fact. Multiple rulers. Number two, not follow my sunnah. Number three, not follow my guidance. Number four, hearts of devils in the bodies of men. Hadith in Sahih Muslim, narrated Hudhayfa. And it is Hudhayfa who is following up the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Hudhayfa said at the beginning of the hadith, he said, يَسْعَلُونَ النَّاسِ وَيَسْعَلُونَ نَاسُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ سَلَّمَ عَنِ الْخَيْرِ وَأَسْأَلُهُ عَنِ الشَّرِ. That the people used to ask the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the good things. As for me, I used to ask him about the evil things out of fear that they would reach me. Out of fear that they would reach me. So he said, this is why I asked him. So the hadith becomes lengthy up until it reaches this stage. When he keeps asking the Messenger of Allah. And the Messenger of Allah said, you will have rulers over you. And they will not follow my sunnah, not follow my guidance. Hearts of devils in the bodies of men. So Hudhayfa said, what shall we do? Ya Rasulullah, what shall I do if I reach that time? Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Isma wa ati'il al-Amir. He said, hear and obey the Amir. Hear and obey him. In dalaba dahruk. وَإِنْ أَخَذَ مَالُكَ. Even if he beats you in your back, and even if he takes your wealth, hear and obey the Amir. Hudhayfa did not argue with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. كَيْفَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ How are we going? No, ya Rasulullah, we can't accept. Never. This is the way of the people of today and the Khawarij, and those who claim love for the Sunnah, but they don't really love the Sunnah. Look at Hudhayfa, he didn't argue with the Prophet ﷺ, not a kalima thereafter. No argument. Ya Rasulullah, no. How can we not fight them? Look at how many it was almost as if the Prophet ﷺ was adding more and more characteristics of wickedness to the ruler. To show Hudhayfa, look, however far you take this limit, I will not let you rebel. It is not from the revelation to rebel. Look at those characteristics now. How many? Rulers, plural. Those people who walk around saying that there must be only one ruler, if there's more than one ruler in any part of the Islamic world, then we don't accept any of them up until we make them one. Which is batil. After the time of the Sahaba, the rulership split in the different lands, as Ibn Taymiyyah mentions, rahimahullah. And each ruler had his own land in which he was ruling. And they were kings. They were kings. Umar bin Abdul Aziz was a king. Yazid, the son of Muawiyah, was a king. Rather, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan, the Sahabi, was a king. After the Khulafa al-Rashideen, there was kingship. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the Khilafah will remain in my ummah for 30 years. Hadith in Sunan Abi Dawud. And the hadith is authentic. And there are more than one, and there is more than one narration, several narrations. The Khilafah will remain in my ummah for 30 years, then there will be kingship. Then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then there will be a tyrannical kingship. Then there will be the biting kingship, then a tyrannical kingship, then there will be a return to the Khilafah upon the manhaj of Nabuwa, to the Khilafah or to the establishment of the Islamic State upon the methodology of prophethood. So Ibn Taymiyyah said, that being the case, that the kingships or the dominions and the kingdoms, they split. And he said, and upon the people of each one of those countries or each one of those lands is to give the bay'ah to the king that is in charge of them. And he said, and this is something, Ibn Taymiyyah said, that is accepted. And it is a reality. And that we do not rebel against each one of them or any one of them. But the point here being that look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How many of us or how many of the Muslims today will accept this hadith? How many of them will say that I submit? Taslim. Because the manhaj of Ahlul Sunnah, the manhaj of the Salafi is, whether it's bitter or whether it's sweet, we submit to it. Just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُبَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجْرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَدَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. No by your Lord that they will never truly believe up until they make you, O Muhammad, the judge in all of the disputes between them. And then thereafter, they will not find in their hearts any resistance to that which you have judged in. And they will submit with a complete submission. So where is the submission to these types of hadith? Even if he beats you in your back, takes your wealth, doesn't follow the sunnah, doesn't follow the guidance, has the heart of a devil, don't rebel against him. Don't rebel against him. That's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded obedience to that ruler. Now all of these political groups out there, how many of them are submitting to this? Too hard for them. Because this now opposes the group that they're following, the sect that they're following. They are not Salafi. You cannot be Salafi if this is your understanding of the deen, that I will treat the sunnah like a buffet bar. You know, just like you have a buffet, you walk past, oh, I like that one, I'll take that. Oh, no, not that one. Oh, that one looks nice. Sunnah is like this. This is not the sunnah. The sunnah is everything. That's why Allah said what he said, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. By your Lord, they will not truly believe. Up until the end, what did he say? Up until they submit with a complete submission. No buffet. You take it all. All of it is sunnah. If you find that you can't practice it all, then submit. And say, oh Allah, make me strong. Like for example, a man in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he drank wine. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had him lashed, had him flogged. He drank wine again. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had him flogged again. Drunk wine again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had him flogged again. So then some of the companions, they said, they started reviling him. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, stop. Do not aid the shaitan against your brother. In a narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he asked him why, he said, Wallahi, I love Allah and His Messenger. Affirming his weakness to this issue. It's not because he was saying, for me, alcohol is allowed and I don't care about anybody else. He knew his weakness. Like the woman who came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she said, Ya Rasulullah, I fornicated. I committed adultery. She understood that she made a mistake. She wanted from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, repent to Allah. She said, no, I want the hukam of Allah. I want the judgment of Allah established upon me. He turned away from her. And he turned away from her a third time. He said, what do you want? She said, I want the judgment of Allah. These were believing people. So after she was punished for what she did, some of the people said, started speaking ill of her. So the Prophet ﷺ said that indeed her tawbah has encompassed 70 of the people of Medina. Why? Because those people, even in their mistakes, because humans will make mistakes. Even in their mistakes, they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sought His forgiveness. Not like some of the people of today and the people of the sects, that they will oppose the deen of Allah and arrogantly claim that what they are upon is the deen of Allah, whilst knowing it is not the deen of Allah. So rebelling against the Muslim rulers, knocking on people's doors and going out for 40 days, burying dead people inside of mosques, and then ascribing this to Islam. Look at the hadith or the athar of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud when they were counting pebbles in the masjid. That in the time of Ibn Mas'ud, Sahabi, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari came to the masjid and he saw the people standing, sitting in circles. In the middle of the circle there was 100 pebbles. 100 pebbles. So they would pick up a pebble and say, Subhanallah, and the people would repeat, Subhanallah. Then Alhamdulillah, repeat Alhamdulillah, 100 times each time. So if Abu Musa al-Ash'ari went to Ibn Mas'ud and waited for him outside of his house for Fajr, then they came to the masjid, and Ibn Mas'ud came to one of those servants and said, what are you doing? What is it that you are doing? They said, we're making dhikr. He said, oh Ummah of Muhammad, how quickly have run to your destruction. For indeed, the clothes of the Messenger of Allah are still being worn. They are not worn out. His crockery has not yet broken. And his companions are widespread. And already, either you are upon a religion better than the religion of Muhammad, or you are upon a misguided path. What was their answer? The answer was, Ya Abu Abdurrahman, Ya Abu Mas'ud, we only intended good. So what was in their hearts? Good. He said, how many people intend good but they never reach it? He wasn't accepting that as an excuse from them. As far as the Sahaba were concerned, this is how the Prophet ﷺ did it. And you are doing it differently. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum in the time of the Prophet ﷺ never made dhikr in that manner by counting pebbles or counting stones or using dhikr beads or rosary beads or other than that. Even that bid'ah, which is in the eyes of some is nothing. It's only a little thing. What's the big deal? They're saying Subhanallah, Walhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah. What's the big deal? It's dhikr. Whether you count it with pebbles or whether you count it on your hands, what difference does it make? It makes a difference. Because Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, you have run to your destruction. Sahaba are alive. And you have run to your destruction. How many people intend good but they never reach the good? Then at the end of the hadith, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, by Allah, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that there will come a group of people, they will recite the Quran and it will not go beyond their collarbones. Meaning what? They will recite it but they will not understand it. They will not perceive its meanings. It will not sense, it will not sink into the hearts and give them fiqh. It will not give them understanding. He said, maybe you are from them. Then some narrator, he said, by Allah, I saw the very same people. Very same people I saw them at the Battle of Nahrawan. Against Ali radiallahu anhu, fighting against Ali radiallahu anhu and the rest of the Sahaba. So look where it began and look where it finished. It began by counting pebbles, subhanAllah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, wa akbar. But they didn't take the admonition of the Sahabi, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. So shaitan led them astray and made their bid'ah bigger and bigger and bigger up until they made the blood of the Sahaba halal and they fought against Ali radiallahu anhu at the Battle of Nahrawan. So don't regard any bid'ah to be a small bid'ah, and it doesn't matter. All of bid'ah is forbidden. والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. We'll pray inshallah, and thereafter we'll see inshallah if there's an opportunity for questions and answers inshallah.